It is in the eye of the beholder, Mr. Davidson, so they see it as just. And by his subsequent actions, I would say Mr. Pierce has done no more than confound his previous folly. If anything, he has increased the risk. They looked for further enlightenment, but they sought such in vain, for in the scheme of things it made no difference. It is one in which some means must be found to protect him from himself. So, gentlemen, perhaps I should leave you to absorb what you have learned today. I suggest we reconvene at another time to conjure up a solution. I can be found at the White Swan in Clerkenwell. What's in this for you? Was an abrupt question from the present man of mystery. Justice, sir, and the need to see certain folk hang for the foul murder of a poor woman whose only crime was misplaced passion. He was damned if he was going to admit that it was also for self-preservation. Everything he'd heard about the follies of John Pierce convinced him it was necessary to act to avoid ending up in the same boat. Jaleel Tolland was still groggy when, roughly handled, he was thrown on the back of a cart before being covered with a tarpaulin. The route travelled was rutted to begin with, and increasingly so as they left what had to be the road used by the stagecoach. They had moved on to farm tracks, with their passenger wondering into whose hands he'd fallen. The greatest fear was the notion of being handed back to the Navy, but there was little comfort in the idea he could be headed for another destination altogether. Curiosity was heightened when the painful bumping ceased, to be replaced by a smooth surface and the sound of wheels on gravel, something which continued for some time. Acute to any other noise, he heard voices, and then no more gravel, but a surface still smooth, with a slight echo to the sounds, as if he was within some kind of structure. There he lay, listening, hearing nothing for a while, until came the faint sound of what seemed to be several pairs of boots.